Hello, this is Kouri Richins being interviewed on local TV to promote her book. It's about a year after her husband has died, and she explains that the book is a storybook for children to help them to cope with the loss of a parent, and that she wrote it for her three children to help them to deal with their father, her husband's death. But a few weeks after this interview was filmed, Kouri Richins was arrested on suspicion of murdering him. The police did a search of her home after her husband died, and they found that Kouri Richins had a second phone, and that on that phone there were texts between her and someone referred to as CL, who used to clean commercial properties belonging to the Richins. The prosecution alleged that these texts show that Kouri Richins bought drugs off CL, and that first of all she bought hydrocodone before Valentine's Day 2022, and that when that didn't work, when that didn't kill her husband, she then bought fentanyl on two occasions. Eric Richins, her husband, apparently told his friends after Valentine's Day that he had felt really ill after his dinner that night and that he believed his wife was trying to poison him. Kouri Richins' lawyer claims that there's no evidence there was ever any fentanyl in the house or that Kouri Richins ever bought any. But Eric Richins died with five times the lethal dose of fentanyl in his body. And what's more, it seems that not only did he seem to worry, according to his friends, that he was going to be murdered by his wife, but he had actually made financial preparations in case that was to happen. The prosecution alleged that Kouri Richins' motive was money, that she killed her husband because she wanted to buy a $2 million house that he didn't agree to buy, which she closed on the day after he died, and that she hoped to get a lot of money from his life insurance policy and also from his assets. But his life insurance policy was actually changed to his sister's name shortly before he died, and all of his assets, including the home they lived in, were put into a living trust in the name also of his sister. And according to his sister, Kouri Richins was very shocked and upset to discover this. She's since launched a civil case against his estate. I thought it would be interesting to have a look at the interview she did before she was arrested and to see what we can gauge about her personality by the way in which she responds to the different questions she's asked.
A sibling or a friend, talking about loss with kids can be a tricky subject.
First of all, if we look at her expression right at the beginning, it's unusual for a guest on a talk show. I would expect that she would be smiling at the camera.
Joining us now is author of Are You With Me? Kouri Richins, to share her three C's to helping kids cope with grief.
Even if she had experienced a tragic loss a year ago, and even if she was there to talk only about that loss, a really negative subject, I'd still expect her to be smiling at the beginning. That's just what people do. But also, Kouri Richins isn't there to talk about a depressing topic, really. She's there to talk about a book that's supposed to be helping children. So it's a positive topic. My impression is that she's very fixated on how she's supposed to be coming across, and almost that she's trying to work out how a grieving widow might look, and that's what she's trying to emulate.
And Kouri, I want to start with your story. What happened in your personal life?
So my husband passed away unexpectedly last year. So it's March 4th was a 1 year anniversary for us. And he was 39. It completely took us all by shock. And we have three little boys, 10, 9, and 6. And you know, my kids and I kind of wrote this book.
She mentions her husband's death and the shock it was in a rush. It's like she doesn't want to pause. She wants to speed on. That could come across as not wanting to experience a lot of emotion on camera. But if it was about that, I would expect to see strong emotions simmering under the surface at some point during the interview. You know, when she's asked some of these questions that become quite personal. personal about her husband and her children later on, as you'll see. Another reason as to why she might come across like this is she might be numb. But if she was feeling numb, that would surprise me, because her husband died a whole year ago, and during that time, she later claims she has been talking with her children about her husband a lot and listening to their feelings about it. And now, you know, she's obviously written a book about it. So I would expect that this would have made her feel her own emotions too, and that she'd be further along in processing her grief.
And Kouri, I want to start with your story. What happened in your personal life?
So my husband passed away unexpectedly last year. So it's March 4th was a 1 year anniversary for us. And he was 39. It completely took us all by shock.
The sigh seems to show emotion, but she comes across to me as if she's describing a slightly frustrating situation, maybe with a work colleague. It sounds more like an exasperated sigh than a sigh of deep pain.
And he was 39. It completely took us all by shock.
And it's almost like interspersing what she's saying with these sighs in this big rush is more about, you know, it just feels like a lie to me. It just feels fake. And it feels like it's more about trying to remember to add emotion in every now and again, because she was forgetting.
And he was 39. It completely took us all by shock. You know, my kids and I kind of wrote this book on the different emotions and grieving processes that we've experienced last year, and, you know, hoping that it can kind of help other kids, you know, deal with this and kind of, you know, find happiness some way or another.
This also stands out to me, this sentence, hoping they can find happiness in some way or another. Somehow there might be hope that my children will be happy again. I don't think that anyone would believe that about their children, because they wouldn't want to believe it, you know? So no matter how much they were grieving the loss of the children's father, of their husband, they would still want to believe that their kids are going to be fine in the end, that they are going to be happy again. And so I think that this jumps out, that she's saying some way or another. It sounds to me like somebody who is focused on what she wants people to see of her. It's already starting to remind me of Amber Heard and how she came across in court. It seems like Kouri Richins wants people to see her as a grieving widow, and she's playing that role so carefully that she's actually missing some really important parts out of it, and something doesn't really fit or feel right about it. If you try too hard to show that you're telling the truth, it becomes a bit odd, a bit suspicious. There are red flags starting to pop up.
And to make sense and process, I'm sure you felt that going through and trying to explain it and articulate it for you and your boys.
Yes, exactly, exactly. And so I've done, you know, I'm new to all of this, so kind of doing, you know, research.
And Kouri Richins says exactly twice, and it's sort of like she's thinking, yes, that was the correct answer. That is what I should have said.
Yes, exactly, exactly.
The host adds to make sense of it and process it. So the host is thinking about real grief, and she has to add this, because that is what you might, I mean, that's why you would write a book like this. And that shows the host has a proper understanding of what death means for somebody. You know, she understands grieving. She doesn't think of it as you're either happy or you're sad. Like, someone's died, so you're sad and you need to become happy again. It's deep. There's a lot more to it than that, you know, and it's deeper than that. And it seems to me that Kouri Richins has thought the kids are sad, better make them happy again. If she did kill her husband, then this interview and the fact that she wrote this book, that already says so much about her. It says that she doesn't have remorse, that she has a lot of confidence in her ability to manipulate people. I mean, if you think about it, if she killed her children's father and then she writes a book to comfort them, you know, that there's something really twisted about that. And she doesn't have that on her conscience. So she is somebody who doesn't feel grief. She doesn't feel guilt. She doesn't feel responsibility. And she's ruthless.
And reading books and things to try and understand, you know, not only how to grieve as a widow, as a wife, but also, you know, with my kids, how to help them understand what just happened. And what I have kind of found is, as I mentioned, it's kind of the three C's is how I has visualize it. And it's, you know, connection, continuity, and care.
The three C's, that sounds like a good marketing technique. It makes her sound like she's not just a children's author, but she is a children's therapist. You know, she can help you to understand your children and help your children. It makes me think that maybe she's got other ideas up her sleeve, you know, other things she's gonna do next. Maybe she wants to become an influencer of some kind, you know, maybe she wants to write more books. Maybe she wants to write books for adults too. You know, it all seems to me to be a kind of business orientated situation. But there's something about the timing. You know, there's something about the fact that her husband died just a year ago, aged 39. So he was very young, and it was apparently this big shock, and she's got these three children to manage. And you would think that if it really was as horrifying as it was, the last thing that would be on her mind at this point would be the three C's and this business idea. She would just be trying to cope with what's happened. So there's something about the state of mind you need in order to think in this business-like way that suggests that you're not experiencing loads of emotion at that time.
Connection, continuity, and care.
The way she said care, that sounded a bit defensive, as if she's trying to prove something.
Continuity and care. And it's, you know, making sure connection is the one major one, and making sure that their spirit is always alive in your home, you know, and memories are always brought up, and doing things that your loved ones love to do, whether it's riding bikes or their favorite dinner, and just constantly, you know, talking about them. And
Kouri, do you mention at dinner, here's dad, or dad would like this meal, or dad
yes.
would,
yeah.
let's bring dad on a bike ride.
Yeah, exactly. And it's, you know, explaining to my kid, just because he's not present here with us physically, that doesn't mean his presence isn't here with us.
The host says the word dad, and she's just said loved ones. So she is kind of keeping it impersonal, but the host zones in. Dad, and it's about her children's dad. This is the person she has lost in these tragic circumstances when he was only 39. That was such a big shock to her and her poor children. You know, so I would expect that there would be some sign of emotion in her face when the host says dad, but there isn't.
Yeah.
And Kouri, do you mention at dinner, here's dad, or dad would like this meal, or dad
yes.
would...
Yeah.
And then, as she's talking, it seems to me that she's talking in a very impersonal way, as if she's talking about communicating with children about something that matters to them, but that doesn't matter to Kouri.
Bring dad on a bike ride.
Yeah, exactly. And it's, you know, explaining to my kid, just because he's not present here with us physically, that doesn't mean his presence isn't here with us.
As if it's something that Kouri doesn't really relate to.
And he's doing these things with us, and he's, you know, here for birthdays, and he's here for Christmas, and, you know, and it's just comforting to them to know that, you know, they're not living this life alone.
Her husband isn't here for Christmas now, and she is so matter-of-fact about it. The way she gestures, it makes me think of somebody who, aside from feeling enthusiastic, they're not really distracted by emotion. They're very focused on what they're saying, what they want to get across. And again, that doesn't really fit with talking about something that's very personal to you that would, you know, maybe make you feel vulnerable.
He's, you know, here for birthdays and he's here for Christmas and, you know, and it's just comforting to them to know that, you know, they're not living this life alone.
I would have thought that she would have been feeling concerned that they've been feeling alone. I mean, that's really painful for your, you know, to watch your children go through that. And also that you yourself would be feeling so alone, especially with three kids and no help anymore. That would be something that I would expect that you'd see some kind of emotional impact as she talks about this.
Like, Dad is still here, it's just in a different way.
She's very dismissive of the fact that her husband is not here anymore. Well, it's just the same, but just in a different way. It's nothing, really.
It's just in a different way.
And for somebody who's been grieving that loss, they wouldn't possibly be able to kid themselves of that. You know, no matter what religion you are, or how much you believe that people don't really die when they die, you know, they somehow stick around, that nobody is going to therefore have no grief and just be totally fine when they talk about it and genuinely feel like the person might as well be standing in the room, you know.
A different word.
Well, I opened up your book and one of the first pages I saw is a little boy. It looks like he's standing in a hallway at school and he's saying, "Are you still here?"
Yes. Yeah. And it's, you know, and that was like the first day of school and, you know, all the nerves that kids face on the first day of school with new, you know, and just hoping, you know, Dad, like, walk with me, like, help me get through today. Like, give me the strength to do that. And it has found, you know, it's been a lot of peace for my kids. To, you know, to really remember that in the back of their head, that they're never alone, you know, so.
So you actually wrote this.
She sits up straight, which feels like she's dismissing everything that's just been said as that was in the past, that's done. What I've just said is done, now I'm ready to focus on the next thing.
Of their head that they're never alone, you know, so
you act
again, no lasting impact of any of those words on her, when I would expect that she would have thoughts and feelings about what she's just been talking about, because it's about the person she supposedly loved so much who was very suddenly taken from her and her children, and that she wouldn't be able to immediately divert her attention to waiting for the next question, and she wouldn't want to.
They're never alone, you know, so.
So you actually wrote this book with your children.
I did.
Mm-hmm. And it's only been a year. How did you process and say you go from processing death to I need to write a book and help others?
This was going to be a different question. And this chat show hostess, she says later when she's interviewed that she did wonder how on earth Kouri Richins was able in 1 year to process the grief of her husband, you know, her own grief, and to cope with her three children and to help them to cope with their grief and write this book. You know, she found that quite remarkable and strange. And you can hear that she started off as if she was going to ask, how did you manage to do this? And then she changed her question. Maybe she felt like she was coming across as too judgmental. She went from there to, what was your motivation to write the book? Which is a very different question.
So you actually wrote this book with your children.
I did. Mm-hmm.
And it's only been a year. How did you process and say you go from processing death to I need to write a book and help others?
You know, I just watched the struggle that my kids were going through. And I actually, you know, I went on Amazon and Barnes & Noble and trying to find something that we could use to cope at nights. Nights are the hardest, it seems like, for everybody when, you know, dealing with anything. You know, I just watched the struggle that my kids were going through.
She didn't say, I saw that they were struggling. She said, I watched the struggle. And that sounds like someone observing from a distance, not somebody intervening and doing something about it. It makes me think about curiosity, you know, watching something unfold as if it's kind of interesting, as if it's not really your role to get involved. And it makes me wonder about what her feelings would have been if she has murdered her husband and her children are grieving him. Does she have quite mixed feelings about that. Does it annoy her a bit when they miss him? Is it something that she feels like, well, this is about him and them and I'm not really included in this? And that's why she just watches it happen. She doesn't feel like it's got anything to do with her.
But I just wanted some story to read to my kids at night. And I just could not find anything. I couldn't find anything that really, you know, suited them or helped them find comfort and peace. And so, you know, I was like, let's just write one.
Yeah, I believe her that she was searching online for this book for her kids and she couldn't find it. Maybe she was doing it to try to cheer them up with her limited understanding of grief. Or maybe she was just thinking about how there should be something like that and she needed to create it if there wasn't. Either way, I think what ended up happening was she saw there was a gap in the market and that this would be a great business idea. You know, and I wonder if this is about her thinking that she's getting revenge on her husband because she will make a profit from his death one way or another and he can't control that.
Help them find comfort and peace. And so, you know, I was like, let's just write one.
And when she says, let's just write one, it feels like she's really proud of herself, like she's come up with a solution and very confident. And again, that doesn't feel right considering the context. I'd expect that if she was talking about cleaning and saying that, you know, she could never get to the corner of the windows. And so let's create an answer, you know. And so I came up with this, and that she'd be proud of herself and just feeling really positive. But someone very, very precious has been taken from their lives. And there isn't going to be a sudden solution that's going to fix that for them or supposedly for her. And so the way she says it, I would expect less positivity, you know, less excitement and more of, you know, something more serious and as more as if she's thinking, I think this could be helpful rather than here's the answer.
Help them find comfort and peace. And so, you know, I was like, let's just write one. And so, you know, I took things that my kids have said to me this last year and we kind of articulated it and put it into a story and, you know, just have hopes that it will help other kids.
And all of that nodding that she's doing about how she's collating these ideas from her and her kids.
I took things that my kids have said to me this last year.
It feels like she's validating herself and there's no sort of doubt. There's no, again, vulnerability. And it, again, feels very removed and distant. I would expect that a mother in her position would feel a lot of guilt quite easily because they'd think, what could I be doing better for my kids? How could I be helping them to cope better? There must be something else I could do.
Grief is not linear, and this sounds like it's a touchstone when you need it to come back to for you and your boys. So the first one you had mentioned was connection of the three C's, keeping the person's spirit alive. The second, continuity.
Yes, and that's, you know, just making sure you're trying to stay, you know, as much as you can on routine. And, you know, whether that's, you know, sports or pick up and drop off from school or community activities, just, you know, trying to stay in a routine as much as possible.
And then the last C is care.
Yes.
What does that mean?
She seems to struggle when she's talking about the third C, care. Notice how many times she says just and you know. Notice how many times she says you know.
So, you know, on top of just loving your kids and hugging them and kissing them and, you know, extra cuddles and everything, I think it's important that I've learned to really affirm, you know, their feelings. When they're mad or they're sad, you know, it's just that affirmation of, I understand, like, that you are upset, you know, because of this. Like, let's talk about it, you know. And so I think really it's not, you know, it's the emotional and physical touch of it. But really letting your kids understand that you know why they're feeling the way that they are feeling, and it's okay, and let's deal with it and talk about it.
If she's killed her husband, it would make sense that talking about how much she cares for her kids and in what ways is going to be a struggle. And it's also going to be a struggle if she doesn't actually feel that way about her children.
Go ahead.
Dear Judge Mrazek, I'm here today to represent my brother, Eric Eugene Richins, whose life was taken in a senseless act of poisoning on March 3rd, 2022. His wife, the defendant, has been accused of committing this crime. My sister, Katie, was now the executor of Eric's trust and estate. And just like Eric, she would not want the defendant breaking into his gun safe. Kouri looked at me with pure hatred and rage. I was messing up her plan. I was getting in her way. And because of that, she attacked me. She punched me in the face and neck multiple times. It took four people to pull her off me that day. Since Eric's death, it has come to our attention that Kouri took out multiple life insurance policies on Eric without his knowledge. It appears that she forged his signature on various documents, assigned herself as Eric's durable power of attorney, inappropriately diverted money from his business to herself, and assigned herself as beneficiary of Eric's portion of our mother's retirement account. I should also not forget to mention the multiple life insurances she has taken out on the boys. Because of her actions, there has not been a day that has gone by we have not lived with paralyzing anxiety and fear, worrying for the boys' lives as well as our own.
There's a promotion right now. Get a free copy of the book April 30th and May 1st through Amazon Kindle. You are an amazing woman and mom, and
thank you
for being vulnerable and sharing this and touching the lives of others.
Thank you. I really appreciate being here. So,
thank you, Kouri. Guys. Thank you.
I feel for those talk show hostesses, though. I mean, if she has murdered him, imagine interviewing a murderer about how to help her grieving children. Crazy. I'm going to leave it here. If you haven't subscribed, please subscribe. Please hit the notification bell and have notifications turned on. You have to do those three things to get one of my videos, you know, to know when I'm putting up a video.